It's Nori Nori, and I am so excited to welcome you to this wonderful interview. We're going to talk to Catrise Harris. She is an author, a mother. She's a survivor. She's an incredible human. And so we're going to get to know her a little bit better as we kind of journey through what she's been through and why she is telling her story and why her story is so powerful. How are you?
I'm good. How are you?
I'm wonderful. I'm very happy to be here. So you're an author, you're a businesswoman, you're a mother. You're coming off of a really large conference in Atlanta, which has been, pretty exciting to take the main stage and to be able to share your testimony. Talk to me about why you decided to become an author and to write it down. It's one thing to live it and experience it. It's another thing to share it as a testimony and to kind of seal it in ink.
Yes, absolutely. And I'm so glad you asked that question. So what I like to tell people, it started from childhood, right? So I used to journal a lot as a child. My daily thoughts, if I had a good day at school, if I had a bad day at school, no matter what it was, I would always ask my mom, you remember the little diaries that had the keys to them?
Yes.
As I had my diary, and believe it or not, I kept them all the way from childhood in a U-Haul box that traveled with me from home to home, storage to storage. I never got rid of them. And so when I started to write my book, I was actually, and I'm letting you in on this secret. I have never told anyone else this, okay? I was actually writing my book as a tell-all. And in the midst of writing my tell-all, from my industry-based career, God convicted me in the middle of writing the book and said, writing a tell-all book is not, that's not what you want to do. That's not what you want. It's just not going to give you a good look. So let's try this and reach your readers in a positive manner. So without telling your story in a negative way, let's tell it as a testimony so that you can win souls and reach out to other people that have been a victim like you have. So in the midst of writing that tell-all book, God convicted me to write a testimony. And that's exactly what I did.
You know, you talk about tell-all books. I'm sure it was kind of hard to kind of back away from that, because that was a very popular thing to do at one point. I read quite a few Video Vixen books because it was juicy. It was like, ooh, what's happening behind the curtains, behind the scenes of this industry that looks so glamorous. So speaking of a glamorous industry, your book and your testimony is one of surviving. So Talk to me about that parallel, being that it's about your looks, it's about how you carry yourself, it's about being presentable so that you can book the jobs that you want, that you can be selected off of, you know, looks and how that worked out for you.
Yes. So being back in that time in the industry, I started at a very young age. And I was always around industry friends. As I got older, I started to date people in the industry. And when I started to date people in the industry, I kind of stayed in the background, if that makes sense. Never came to the front, never really wanted to be known. And I ended up dating men that took me through a lot of abuse, physically and mentally. So I always like to remind women that when you think that's what you want, a lot of times there is a price that comes with that, right? And I'm not going to say that for every industry, person, but I will say I've dated quite a few industry men, and there is definitely a price that comes with that. I decided to go on this spiritual journey of realizing that, traveling, going on the road, having this successful life actually became a demonic life. There is a lot that go on behind the scenes. There is a lot that, have you ever heard that saying, when you go to Vegas, what happens on the road, stay on the road kind of thing?
Yes, I have.
That's kind of what happens in industry life. It's kind of like hush, hush, you don't discuss anything, whatever happens, happens kind of thing. And I dealt with so much abuse that I decided to walk away from that industry. I decided to be a mother. You know, I have three beautiful, amazing children. And I decided to go more into the motherly role, which is why I became a businesswoman, opened several businesses in Atlanta, and decided to share my story, not just because of other people that have been victimized, but to share it with parents so that parents can see the signs in their children of why they act out and why they do certain things, because some parents may not be aware of what's happening to their children. And again, it started from childhood for me.
You know, you talked about paying a price, and then there was like this catalyst of change that happened in your life. When did you know the price was too high?
When you are asked to do things that bring you out of character. I was exposed to things that I knew wasn't me. And I wasn't willing to go down the road and to do some of the things that I was asked to do. And I don't want to be an emotional roller coaster in this interview, so I'm going to probably limit how much I say in that department, because it does flare up my emotions sometimes. But when you know who you are, you should never allow someone to strip your dignity. That is something you should never allow to happen. I allowed those things to happen to me, where there was sometimes I didn't even know who I was. I didn't know my true identity sometimes. And I thank God for bringing me out of those circumstances and being a voice for me and allowing me to become mentally healthy, because your mental is everything. And that industry can ruin you. It can really ruin you and have you doing things that is just not of you. So if you're not doing it for a positive reason, I mean, there are so many industry people you can talk to that will tell you they were asked to do things. They were, you know, and they had to think, is this worth me doing? Is this worth the price or is it not? No, it's not worth the glamour at all. No.
Absolutely. I think, you know, there are so many women and men, but women especially, that look at the glamour and they are laser focused on it, right? And so with you turning your story, your journey into a testimony, scared but not broken, how does it make you feel when I say family?
How does it make me feel when you say family? Mm-hmm. In this very moment, joyful. I would have to say I'm in a very good place now. I'm in a very, very good place now, a place of healing. Mm-hmm. I apologize for that. I'm in a place of healing. Me writing my story, I actually wrote from the past into the future, if that makes sense. So I went all the way back to childhood and I wrote up to probably age 38. I'm 42 now. So I've had many years of coping with my stress and being able to heal. My children is my world. That's my immediate family. So I think of joyfulness when I think of family in this moment.
What do you think about when I say the word relationships, whether it's romantic, platonic, just relationships in general for you?
Relationships can be tricky because my mind goes back and forth between, you know, it goes back and forward between relationships romantically and relationships with friends or family mm-hmm. members, anyone else. And for me, I have had some trial and tribulations with friends, you know, backstabbing, a lot of painful incidents with women that I have grown up with and known a very long time. Sometimes when your success starts to rise, you start to see people, you know, start to change. They think you're changing, but a lot of times it's them changing because sometimes people have the envy and jealous spirit that you didn't see before, but you started to see towards the end. And romantically wise, sometimes it brings back memories from past relationships. And you have to remember, you can't bring what happened in a previous relationship into a current relationship. I had issues with doing that, which is why I sat down. I don't know if you're familiar with Dr. Tart.
Yes, I love Dr. Tart.
Yes. So I'll give you a quick scenario really quick. Dr. Tart is the one that got me to open up and to write Scarred But Not Broken. I was sitting on it. I had journalized the entire book, but never really put it into format. Every chapter I wrote, I had a breakdown emotionally, because memories were, you know, being brought back up.
Yeah.
And in the first chapter, I went right into, you know, how some people will start slowly and work their way to the top and get to the good stuff towards the end. I went right in after that station. Okay. And I had so many breakdowns with that chapter that I had to see Dr. Tart, who helped me get through so many of those trials and tribulations in order to get to the end of that book. And our office was like neck and neck with each other in the same building, same floor. I would walk past him, he would walk past me, and he would always say, "She never speaks. Who is she? You know, she doesn't say much, you know." But I would get my clients and I would just go to the back. And finally, one day we were able to converse in the kitchen, getting coffee at the same time. And then I was able to give him a little background about myself. And then I was like, you know what? I need to sit down and talk to you, when I found out who he was. So actually, I thank him, because he did allow me to release my emotions in the book. And it was a great help. Yeah.
I was going to ask you that, therapy, how did, you know, therapy play a role in helping you to process your trauma and things that you've been through? Because by you processing your trauma, you're helping a lot of people to acknowledge their trauma. And a lot of times in the Black community, we ignore stuff. We like to act like it never happened, or it was another, you know, that was me before I found myself, but it's still a part of you.
Absolutely. And I think that is an issue in the Black community, because I recognized that I needed therapy as a child. But again, you know, Black families just didn't believe in therapy and counseling back then. You know, I was labeled as a bad child. So everything for me was a physical punishment. I never got verbalized. I was never sat down and talked about things. It was automatically a beating. So to this day, it's weird, because I'm not a physical disciplinary with my children. I verbalize everything with them, because I want parents to understand everything doesn't require physical punishment for children. You have to be able to talk to them sometimes. But I will say this. Therapy is so needed. Some people think it's not. I'm telling you it is. I was able to learn to cope with my stress. I didn't know how to cope with stress at all until I went to therapy. And Dr. Tart wasn't my first therapist. That was just my therapist to help get me through this book, because I kept having emotional flare-ups. But prior to that, I had seen private therapists prior to adulthood. Throughout my childhood, I went to therapy a lot, and I was able to learn a lot about myself. And that's why to this day, even in my dating life, sometimes I say, oh, I feel sorry for whoever gets me, because now I'm at a point in my life, I know exactly what I want. I know what I would tolerate, what I won't settle for, all of those things, because therapy helped you to identify your true identity. And that's just being honest.
Talk to me about being sure of yourself, because sometimes it can be, sometimes other people process that as a negative thing. And it's such a beautiful growth that we have. And, you know, when we've been through our trauma and then we're showing growth, but then you encounter somebody that's not ready to receive that growth, how do you push through? What does pushing through look like for you personally, when you know who you are and other people are not ready to receive you as a complete person?
Absolutely. One of the main things I had to learn is everybody can't jump on the wagon with you. There are some people you're just going to have to leave at the bus stop, and they're going to have to wait on the next bus to come. When you get on that bus, you got to keep going, and you cannot look back. I do realize that some people are not going to understand where you are in your life. I'm a very gentle person. I usually come across very soft, natural, gentle. I'm usually able to express myself in a positive manner. So even when I'm talking to someone else, I always try to get them to see my point of view and then another point of view. But the main thing is my mental health, right? Mm-hmm. And I want to encourage you to be here with me. But if that does not look like what my vision looks like, my strength have surpassed all of the negativity that I have gone through. We're gonna have to get through it together, or I'm gonna have to leave you at that destination. I'm really about self-care in this moment of my life right now. I'm really all about self-care.
Talk to me about the power of saying no. A lot of times we say yes to a lot of different things, but it sounds like what I'm hearing you say is you've really owned the ability to step back and to say no. And it looks good on you. It really does.
And it's funny that you say that, because I just put this huge post up on Facebook. And what I was trying to explain is that I've always been a yes person. In all of my relationships, I was overly submissive. So when I hear Black men say Black women are not submissive, that is not true. I was overly submissive, and I was probably a little too submissive for them not to be my husband. So everything was yes for me, with my children, with family, with friends, money, loaning, borrowing, everything was yes for me. I felt like I was the fixer. And I started getting burned out with it. It started becoming overwhelming. And as I started going through my spiritual journey and my healing, I became a no person. And when I walked out of my last therapy session, I call it a graduation. Mm-hmm. I feel like when I came out of that session, I identified that with the fact that I was going to lose a lot of people along the way, because it was going to be a lot of no's for me. And people were not used to that. That's including family. Okay. And I would say within the last 2 years, I've had to split from a few people because they didn't get to hear the word yes that they were used to. It was an absolute no for me. And that's been one of the hardest things in my life, to say no. Now I don't even just say no. I say absolutely no, with no problem. Okay. And I keep everything. Because happy. And I can do that knowing, now, unless God speak to me and tell me to do something, I'm very obedient in that department. If God tells me to do something, I move and I do exactly what I'm told to do. But you and I both know we live in a time now where people play the victim a lot, and you can't be the victim once a week. You know, everything bad is happening to you once a week. You have a lot of people that mismanage their funds, but then they want to come to you for your funds and do what they want to do with their funds. And that was the biggest no for me going forward, was loaning out money, because I would see people on social media traveling, going on vacation. I'm like, wait a minute, you still owe me $1,500, but you're going to Miami. Those are things that I'm not buying friendships. No, it's a no for me.
You know, you have also expressed the importance of your spiritual journey and how that has been a foundational, I would say a foundation for you to continue to build. Why is that so important? Because I do feel like a lot of times people are dismissive of your personal relationship with God. And I think that is priority. I think that is so important. And some people are scared to talk about it out loud. In their homes, they're private, you know, they keep it to themselves, that they, you know, enjoy communing with God and having a spiritual relationship. Talk to me about why that is so important and why you're so vocal about that.
I recognize where my strength comes from, where my health, and I don't want to get emotional, but I remember days when I was contemplating suicide, like I was ready to jump off of the first cliff that I saw. And it was God's voice in my ear that whispered so gentle. And he said, this world would miss you when you're gone. This is not the time for you to fight battles. It's my job to fight these battles. You just have to give it to me. And when you give it to me, I'm going to fight that battle for you. But you're victorious. This is not the time for you to give up. You have children that love you. There are a lot of people in this world that love Catrise. And I didn't feel like that in that moment. I felt scarred, and I felt like my scars was just never going to heal. And in that moment, I knew that God was as real as he gets. And from that day forward, I had to realize where my health, you know, there are several times I've been in the hospital that I was in there for stress and they were thinking I had a mini stroke, and the whole time it wasn't. It was just stress weighing on me. God just, he outdid himself, you know, he outdid himself. Everything that I've asked for, he has given me. He's kept his hands on my children. He's kept his hands on my family. He's kept his hands on me. And sometimes I wonder, how can you not love him? And with all the businesses that I own, I don't discriminate on people that I hire. I don't know if I have atheists working for me to this day. But one thing that I will not do is stop worshiping and praising God. When I walk into my office, I pray walking in there. Mm-hmm. I pray when my feet touch the floor and when I jump in those vehicles that I own. I pray and I thank God for traveling mercy and for giving me everything that I have. At one point in my life, material things had me. Mm. God stripped them and took everything away from me. And when he gave it back to me, he gave it back to me much more than what I had before. But he taught me how to not let those things have me. He's a jealous God. And once I identified with him being a jealous God and me making sure that I put him first at all times, my life have been so blessed going forward. And I don't discriminate on what other people's beliefs are. That's what I like to tell Christians. It's not my job to judge people on their belief, whether they're atheists, whether they're Jehovah's Witness. It's not our job to judge. What I feel is that you don't let anyone take away your beliefs, but you also don't judge them for their beliefs. We're all family at the end of the day when I look at it.
Absolutely. You know, you have your book. It's called Scarred But Not Broken. For people that want to get that book, learn more. And also, you know, sometimes when you hear of someone else's story and it is so similar to your own story, it allows you to know that there is an other side. Like, you can come through the other side. So, for people that want to read your book and want to stay connected with you, can you share that information?
Absolutely. So the book is on different platforms. Amazon, of course, you can go directly to Amazon, Barnes and Nobles, Scribble, also our direct website, which is iamcatrise.com. If you'd like an autographed copy, you can go through iamcatrise.com directly to receive that. Also, my social media pages, I am Catrise, Instagram, I am Catrise, Facebook, I am Catrise 41, TikTok.
All right, we got you. Now, we're not done. You're also working on another book. It is titled Dear Black Man, It's Okay to Cry. I love the title. I love the title, because I think it's so important for a Black man to be okay with being vulnerable.
Absolutely.
Talk to me about, you know, working through this next book and what can we expect?
Absolutely. So, you know, what's weird, I was actually writing a different book called Co-Parent, right?
Okay.
And this is what I'm trying to tell you is super real. So I was writing a book called Co-Parent. I've always wanted custodial parents and non-custodial parents to realize that if the relationship didn't work, it's okay, but you still have to be able to co-parent properly for the sake of the children. So I was writing the book to give them tools to be able to co-parent and to work and do what's right or what's best for the children, shall I say. And in the midst of that, I just had this deja vu of Dear Black Man, It's Okay to Cry. So I called my, not my PR team, but I called my publisher and I said, hey, I need you to do some research on this title, because all of a sudden I'm writing one thing and then this book comes up. And I know why it came up in my spirit, because I deal with a lot of broken Black men. a lot of them. And with my gentle and soft approach, people confide in me all the time. I'm not a counselor. I'm not a therapist, but I feel like I am with the way that people confide in me about their lives. And owning an accounting firm, you know, I have a lot of Black men that they wait for their yearly visit with me to express what have happened in their lives. And I started to sit in the child abandonment. I don't know if you've heard of child abandonment, where if a man goes 30 days behind on child support, let me not say a man, because it can be male or female. Mm-hmm. But whenever the non-custodian parent goes behind on child support 30 days, the custodial parent gets to file what they call a child abandonment warrant, where they can be arrested if they go 30 days past child support. So I went to sit in the courts of DeKalb County, Georgia, and I was listening to some of the stories and you know, trying to get a feel for what I was going to write and how I was going to write. And there was some Black men in there that was really, really trying. And the women was, I mean, they were literally $200 behind. They had been paying their child support on time, such a small amount. And the women was just dragging them, or, you know, belittling them in the courtroom. You know, that's why you work at Wendy's, or that's why you're, you know, right in the courtroom. And I was like, we're breaking these Black men down further and further and further. And then we get upset when they turn to other nationalities or they start to date other races. And we have to understand, as Black women, we are their queens and they are our kings. And we have to find boundaries to protect our Black men, especially in the world we're living in today. So I want Black men to know, going forward, it doesn't make you a punk. It doesn't make you a softie. It doesn't make you any of that. It is okay to be vulnerable and to cry. I'd rather you let it out than to hold it in.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. You know, you are easy to talk to. I'm not going to hold you. Like, you do have this very sweet and welcoming spirit about you that, I can see why people are like, yeah, it's time for my appointment. All right, I'm ready to pull up. Because you really are welcoming. And I just think that's a testament to how far and how beautiful God can bring you, because you could have stayed in a state of brokenness, or a lot of people just kind of wallow in their past and don't get over the fact that they have the ability to overcome and we have choices in life. And so I'm really happy that we are celebrating your resilience and your, you know, personal relationship and growth, because it's so important. So you know, telling your story and being very transparent and open, ultimately, what do you want people to walk away from, whether it is personal encounters with you or business encounters with you? What do you want to continue to put out into the world?
I want to continue to put out positivity in the universe. I want people to be able to identify with who they are. I want them to feel strong when they read a book of mine. I want them to be able to rebuild their brokenness, their mental state of mind. I want them to say, every time I see her speak or every time I read one of her books, I feel so much empowerment. I want to be able to leave positivity in the universe.
Well, you are definitely doing that. Once again, please share out how people can stay connected with you.
Absolutely. Please stay connected with me. TikTok, I am Catrise41. Instagram, I am Catrise. Facebook, I am Catrise. Thank you. Please, please, please stay connected.
Yes, I have definitely enjoyed our time. Thank you so much. And wishing you all the best and much, much success. More books, more testimonies. And with that, like, I'm not saying more trials and tribulation. I'm saying continuing to spread that positivity and to grow and move forward. So congratulations on all of your success. And you're a beautiful person. You really are, inside and out. So a pleasure.
Thank you so much. I appreciate it.